Carlito's Way. I wrote it in longhand and so forth, because I don't type, I write everything in longhand. I wrote it in the first person, and I drew a composite of a lot of the guys that I grew up with, things I'd seen at first hand, because there's nothing fabricated in my novels. Somebody said what I quote, because I have an indelible memory for dialogue like that. And the events, some of them may appear fantastic, but they're mild compared to some of the things that I didn't even include. And I kind of put all that together in what I thought was a sort of a vehicle for film. First guy I was shown to was the editor-in-chief at Warner Books, was Howard Kaminsky, and he immediately saw its potential. He said, no, this has to be published as a hardcover vehicle, and then subsequently as a paperback vehicle with Warner Books. The critical reception was very good. The cinematic interest was almost immediate. I had a lot of, you know, interest from producers and whatnot, and there were various options over the years. And then Marty Bregman put the thing together.
Many years ago, I got involved with Carlito's Way through a strange set of circumstances. Pacino came to me with a script based upon two books written by Eddie Torres, who's a criminal judge in New York. He said to me, Marty, he says, read this for me, and it was just terrible. Maybe one of the worst screenplays I've ever read, and I've read some real turkeys. I said, you know, my opinion, I wouldn't touch this with a 10-foot pole, and I don't think any studio will. But Al, he liked the character. The character was a very well-defined character in the Torres books. There were two books based on the same character. I had read the books. Al asked me whether I would be interested in developing this into a movie. And that's how it started. I hired a writer who had worked with me before, David Koepp, and we were off to the races.
I was working on something for Marty Bregman, and he liked what I was doing, and so gave me the two Edwin Torres novels on which Carlito's Way is based, which are Carlito's Way and After Hours. Carlito's Way is the first, and After Hours is the sort of further adventures of Carlito Brigante. I loved them. The books were incredibly specific. You know, I mean, the voice is so vivid and so there from the first page. The problem was that there was 800 pages of material and, you know, how to find the movie in it. I also felt a certain amount of hesitation because, you know, Spanish Harlem in the 1970s is not exactly my background, you know. And I thought, I'm not sure where I get off writing about this. But then I realized, since the voice is there and the characters are there, and Torres is such a gregarious and willing author, you know, and wanted to talk and help and guide in any way he could. So then when I realized my job was primarily going to be structural and I would have all these assets, then I felt like I could do it.
The screenplay, as it evolved, a very excellent screenplay, the tilt was toward more After Hours because of the age factor. Carlito's Way takes Carlito Brigante from his teens into, let's say, his late 20s or early 30s. And then After Hours picks him up after that, after he's done a long stint in prison. So of necessity, Pacino could not play him as an adolescent almost, and then as a very young man. So in essence, they elected to call the film Carlito's Way. But in fact, the screenplay is primarily based on After Hours.
After I had a screenplay written, then I went to De Palma. I thought Brian could add, certainly cinematically, the right tone to this. Brian is a very intelligent director. This was not an exploitive piece. He's one of our great directors. That's why I went to Brian.
Well, I was in Los Angeles, and my agent sent me the script, Carlito's Way. I didn't even want to read it. I didn't want to do another movie with Spanish-speaking gangsters. And he kept on saying, you've got to read the script, you've got to read the script. And I ultimately got convinced to read it. And it was only because I liked the script so much that I did it, because I did not want to return to this particular terrain again. I thought I'd done it in Scarface. As much as I liked working with Bregman and Pacino, it's a long, difficult struggle. But the script was so good that I said, I gotta make this, and that's what convinced me. I didn't find it that dissimilar, having spent a lot of time with Spanish gangsters. The sensibility is very similar, whether they're Cuban or Puerto Rican. What was different was Eddie Torres is a real guy.
I recollect going with him up to Spanish Harlem, to the barrio, and walking the streets with him and pointing out, you know. I mean, I'm a veteran of those streets. Just about every corner that I can tell you, so-and-so got shot here, so-and-so got stabbed here. I mean, you know, this sort of thing.
We had Eddie Torres to follow and watch. And that's what I like about Spanish gangsters. You sort of have the Italian kind of warm feeling, familiar, religious thing going on. And then you got all the music. You have this great Latin music, which I don't think you have with the Italian gangsters. That's what makes it a whole different world for me.
I wrestled for a long time with whether or not to use this voiceover.
Somebody's pulling me close to the ground. I can sense, but I can't see.
Voiceover can be overused and it can be terrible. But in this case, I just didn't see any way to tell the story without it. So when I came on that idea, which is that the whole thing takes place in the second or two that Carlito is remembering right before he dies, that was when I felt like I really had a structure in which I could incorporate all the best material. Before Brian got involved, the voiceover took place in a hospital. And then Brian's idea was to move it to the train station where he'd almost, you know, it's such a romantic image. That's what I love about it. There's so much that echoes of the 40s filmmaking in this. Brian's idea was, which I loved, was that the whole movie takes place in a moment when the wheels of the stretcher get stuck in a crack in the floor. The whole movie's a recollection from right there.
It's a classic film noir concept, you know, the guy that gets shot at the beginning of the film recounting. Obviously, Sunset Boulevard is the prime example. I was trying to do it in a way that you would be brought back to the sequence and not realize you were in the death scene until it was too late.
The indictment is dismissed. The prisoner's discharged. Call the next case.
The name Brigante, it's a Corsican name. There was a whole lot of smuggling going on in Corsica, even before the dope trade. In the center of Puerto Rico, where my parents come from, there was a large in the 19th century immigration of Corsicans. So that's where I got the idea that he was of that origin.
I'm retired.
Carlito Brigante is kind of a composite of a lot of guys I grew up with. And it's autobiographical too. Some of the earlier episodes in the book of a non-criminal nature, I might add, are me. Most of it is from the guys that I grew up with. And there are a lot of guys in Harlem, those that are left, who claim they are the prototype for Carlito Brigante. But I always dismiss them. I say, you're too ugly. He was a good-looking guy. Or, you never made any money. Or, you never killed nobody, you know, that sort of thing. But he's really a composite of several guys. Three in particular. But, you know, to protect the guilty, I'm not going to give names.
Pacino is a fascinating actor. No matter what he does on screen, audiences like him. I mean, there's a warmth that he has, there's a vulnerability that he has as an actor and also as a man, which comes through.
We're done.
One more. I'm going to bring my shirt
and my undershirt. Absolutely.
Working with him has always been an experience. First of all, he's a close friend. Secondly, he's one of the great actors, maybe in the past 20, 30 years. And when you know somebody as well as I know him, it makes it a lot easier. It makes it a lot easier to communicate. It makes it a lot easier to fight, to argue about things. And we argue a lot. But we've made some pretty good movies together.
This was a lot easier than Scarface, because Al knew me very well now. He was very comfortable with me. There were only a few things I think we got disagreements over, some lines he wanted to do differently. But we basically were like two old warriors going up the hill again. I mean, we had been there, we'd made a lot of movies since we had made Scarface. We were very familiar with each other's style and way of working. And one of the things I was always happy I was able to do with Pacino was to show how beautifully he moves. He is an incredible, beautiful movements, and just to watch him move and to be able to shoot him move and to show the audience the beauty of his movements was quite fulfilling. And Al began to realize that Scarface, that I was shooting in a way that no other director had. And he realizes that I have a kind of particular visual point of view that underscores what he does. And by the time we got to Carlito's Way, he just was very comfortable with what I was doing.
You heard of Carlito, right? Oh, well, what you need him for?
Tranquilo, tranquilo. Just come along for the ride, man.
The language is the language of the street. A lot of that slang or street language in the barrio comes in large measure from the black community because we're very adjacent to one another. We all went to school together and we picked up a lot of their inflections.
Sasso, man, that's Sasso.
And that's what I told Pacino when we shot the film. You're playing a Puerto Rican, but you in effect talk like a black street guy because that's what we spoke like in large measure.
They shotgun you, man, just to see you fly up in the air, man. Chacho, you better off in jail.
In my first draft, there's one character in particular, Pachanga, who really uses heavy slang. And when we got to the first read-through, somebody took me aside and said, you know, there's a lot of rumbling among the, you know, the Latino members of the cast that that's really offensive the way you wrote that shit. And I said, no kidding, you know, it's, I didn't mean it to be. So I went and just changed it all and wrote it in standard English and then just have the actor do a heavier accent, which is always the best thing anyway.
Carlito, the guy got a lot of money, man. He got saved from the office with stacks of hundreds just for the money. Kleinfeld is my brother. Look at me.
Kleinfeld. He is a composite of lawyers, criminal lawyers that I've met over the years.
He's a fucking cokehead, Charlie.
Kleinfeld was a phenomenon that I've observed at first hand, where a guy, an attorney, he gets sucked into this environment, becomes immersed or roped in with these bad guys because they can be very fascinating and seductive almost. You see, the lifestyle, the women, the money, the, in this instance, the cocaine as well. But then he violates a principle that Carlito espouses from an old Spanish aphorism. He would say, juntos, pero no revueltos, which means together, but not mixed up. And that was Kleinfeld's downfall. He got mixed up.
I'm so fucking shook up. I cannot see straight.
That's an offshoot of more than one instance of attorneys whom I have known who became involved with their clients. I know three that were killed, personally.
Sean Penn is an amazing actor. I don't believe anybody told him what to look like. I think Sean had a concept in mind, and he brought to his character an enormous amount of talent. I mean, he was exquisite.
He went home and sort of shaved his head. You know, it came back with this curled, receding hairline look, and we went, oh my God, what have you done? He just likes to look completely different from role to role, and their whole character came with this sort of receding hairline, frizzy hairdo that he did.
And then all the myriad of great performances, because that film produced a lot of guys who went on. But you got Viggo Mortensen, who played Lalín. Certainly my protege, as I call him, Luis Guzmán. He's all over the place.
Ain't no hot Phoenix, Carlito.
Leguizamo, that's probably one of the best portrayals, you know, because his character, Benny Blanco from the Bronx, is an unforgettable character. I've gone to other cities. People will approach me and say, I'm Benny Blanco from the Bronx, you know. I like to juxtapose the contrasting characters, because I've seen that myself at first hand. Here you have a rough, tough, hoodlum Puerto Rican from the neighborhood, and here you have this quintessential, let's say, waspy type girl, but from the Midwest, but she's got a social agenda. Even though they may appear disparate at the outset, in fact, they mesh very well. She sees him perhaps almost as a sociological project almost. She's gonna save him, you see.
You said you wouldn't break my heart, Charlie.
The whole girl thing was very difficult. We looked at everybody. We had a big problem. Of course, she had to do a striptease. This was the mid-90s. This kind of nudity stuff you did in the 70s was becoming very difficult to get an established actress to do. We did screen tests where they, you know, had to do the scenes and then do the striptease. And Penelope, who's a very experienced actress, did both extremely well. He has an idealized vision of her. She's a dancer, you know. So we introduce her in the most idealized way. It's his fantasy. He's going to paradise with this almost angel. Of course, she's not an angel. She's working in a strip joint because she's sort of a hoofer that's not working that much. This is a neighborhood I've lived in all my life. I mean, I live downtown. In the ballet studio, West 10th Street and 6th Avenue.
I was in the road company.
The cafe. And I just walk by these places all the time. So I'm very familiar with them. I've looked in those windows and seen those ballet dancers. I thought, I'll use all these village images that I've seen all my life.
We had the luxury of being able to pace the movie at whatever pace we wanted for two reasons. First, because the character is absolutely compelling. We will listen to people for a long time if they're funny and if they're engaging. And the other thing is, having a really dynamic suspense scene early on buys you more time. That is a very clear promise to an audience about what kind of movie it is and what they can expect later on. So that scene had to be great because then they would trust us and put up with another hour of talk before we got to the suspense again.
It sort of parallels for us the character of Carlito, because this boy is starting on the same road apparently that Carlito has been on and now wants to get away from.
We gotta do some business.
The nephew portrays the innocence, and in the meantime, the savvy Carlito, he knows that something is amiss.
The pool sequence had to be very elaborate and kind of operatic because it was one of the few action scenes in the movie, because so much of the movie is driven by character scenes. So I took a lot of time designing the sets. I remember having it in my architectural program and figuring out what the shape of the room should be and where the pool ball should be, figuring out how to make this shootout interesting. And I remember once Al looked at me and said, "You really can hit a pool ball like that and knock somebody out?" And I said, "Yeah, I've tried it."
We showed an early cut to the studio, and one of their notes was that the pool hall scene seemed too long. I was talking to Brian about it, and I said, "What do you think about this note that the pool hall scene is too long? I don't think they're right about that." And he said, "Oh, no, they're absolutely right. They're absolutely right. But what they mean is that it's not long enough." And I thought he was just being, you know, cheeky and defiant. But actually, no. I mean, he knows suspense so well. He felt that it was just that he had failed to set up a little bit the geography of the suspense, which is, of course, his mastery. You know, the guy's in the bathroom, the door is slightly open, the other guy's over here. You know, all that great establishment of where everybody is and how close they are to each other and what all the stakes are.
We try to cut it to let the film audience understand that by having this point of view and see what the character is seeing. It's a little suspicious. You're looking at Carlito, you see the wheels turning, you understand he's thinking, he's come to a solution in his mind, and he goes and sets up this trick pool shot.
The suspense only works later if that stuff's set up properly before. And so when he went back and furthered some of that coverage and expanded the front of the scene a little bit, the scene was nail-biting and great. And they saw another cut and said, "Much better, shorter, much better, shorter."
In Carlito's Way, we tried to come up with a design that was kind of unique for it. I found this location up in the Bronx, this abandoned club that we ultimately couldn't use, that was in the shape of a boat. So I figured he's getting his boat to go to Puerto Rico to start his car dealership. This is like a big metaphor for where he's going, the boat. So then we proceeded to design the inside of the club like a boat. It's always very important how you introduce a space into a movie, and the space is introduced with him walking into the club. And you want the audience to experience what he's experienced, basically, which is the sort of the wildness of it, the colors, the gaudiness, the speed, the heat. All this thing has to be accomplished in this relentless, heated move through the space. Introduce a space is like introducing a character in a very unique way, so you have a very strong visual impression of it.
Charlie, my friend, Charlie Brigante, how you doing?
The actor that played the corrupt owner of the club, Bregman, had seen him on a Spanish television program. He's like a comedian. And we brought him in, and he just was fabulous. And he doesn't speak a word of English, so he had to learn all of his part phonetically. And Al, Al became extremely frustrated with him because he'd be speaking to him in English, and this guy would sort of be waiting for Al to finish to say that last word that he knows he's supposed to speak now. And you can see Al going nuts with this guy because he couldn't get like an actor's response from him because he didn't understand a word Al was saying except that last word, that was his cue. One sequence we're shooting when he's supposed to be all coked up and he's trying to get Carlito to go help him spring the gangster out of prison. And I think we had done like 10 takes and he'd done it like great on like take 3. And I was shooting over Al to him and he said, I want to do another one. I said, okay. Normally with actors of this skill, they want to do another take and keep shooting until they're happy because who knows what'll happen. And he said, no, I want to do another 15 takes. I said, 15 takes? He said, yes. 15 takes you want to do? He said, yes, I have to do 15 takes. So we started to do these. And then finally, around take 25 or 30, I said, we've got to start shooting, you know, Al. Give him a shot.
I have to do this.
So he was just furious with me. He said, you're ruining the movie, you're copping out, you know, I haven't done my best stuff. And I said, please. You know, can we shoot Al, please? We'll come around, we'll shoot you in a two-shot, and you can do another 30 takes, as far as I'm concerned. We, in fact, went and shot Al, who, needless to say, was well-rehearsed. And he literally got in the car with me and just sort of ranted at me all the way back to New York. I get home, the phone's ringing, and he's still ranting at me. And then the next day, he was fine. That was the only bad day I had with him on that movie.
Just one last piece of business. Got a look in Kleinfeld's eyes.
Brian and I, in the years since, have come to refer to any troublesome scene as the hospital scene, and we know immediately what we're talking about, because we felt we understood the hospital scene well. The actors were continually troubled by it. A lot of actors tend to pick one scene in a movie that is just the linchpin for them, and they absolutely have to get it right. So I think I wrote 25 or 30 versions of the hospital scene. And there was always, you know, an enormous amount of discussion between Pacino and Penn and us about, you know, if this was working or not and what would actually happen. And when the day of shooting came, Brian said, you better show up that day because, you know, you never know. We were ready to go, and we got a message that Al wanted to talk about the hospital scene one more time before we shot it. And we went in his dressing room, and he said that he had finally figured out what he thought the problem with the hospital scene was, and that was that Carlito wouldn't go to the hospital.
Relax, Dave. It's your pal.
Coming on the day of shooting of the hospital scene, that was a bit of a problem. So we went through it one more time and did one final rewrite, which, believe it or not, actually made it better, and then shot what's in the film, which can't be more than 8 lines of dialogue.
I've been to Norwalk's office. I heard the tape.
There was so much for them to say to one another, and yet there was really so little.
Never give up your friends, Dave.
One had betrayed the other. The other had found him out. And that was it. It was really very simple, but there were years and years and years of history. So I think, in a way, all that writing was necessary for them to give the performances they gave. You know, you have to understand all the stuff that's unsaid in order to say the little bit that there is.
So long, Dave. You got a beautiful future.
The contrast is that in the film, Kleinfeld is killed. Whereas, as I wrote it in the novel, Kleinfeld, he was stabbed, but he survived. That's the difference. And then, of course, he will go on, perhaps disbarred, but then it could be reinstated in 7 years, and then we have another Kleinfeld sequel.
There's a delivery for you, Mr. Kleinfeld.
Brian has such a strong sense of order and justice and divine retribution and, you know, that really religious fervor that's in his movies.
And my brother.
It would have seemed like too bleak a world, even for De Palma, I think, if Kleinfeld had gotten away with it and Carlito had to die.
Adios, counselor. Come on!
That chase went on forever. We started the chase in the winter and it ended in the middle of the summer. And Al was wearing that black coat. It was kind of nice in the winter, but we were shooting the train-to-train stuff in the summer. He was sweating to death. And we spent all night trying to get a train-to-train shot, you know, where he's running up the train and being followed by the guys. And at one point, he took the train and went home. He said he had enough. I said to my assistant director, where's the train? And Chris said, I think Al took it back to the station. And when I went to his trailer, I said, Al, we haven't gotten this shot yet. And he looked at me. His face was covered with sweat. He had been running up and down this train, you know, for like 4 or 5 hours in the heat of summer. He said, what are you doing? Because he can't really talk to me because I'm over in the other train trying to shoot these guys moving through windows and stuff going by. I said, Al, it's an extremely complicated shot. And you know, sometimes we see you and sometimes you're blocked, and that's why we've been doing it all night. And he said, okay, let's go and do it, God almighty. So we went back there and we finally got this shot.
My memories of the scene in Grand Central Station are simply that it was a very difficult scene to shoot because it was done in one camera move. It was more difficult for Brian because every move in there was designed by him and planned by him. Nothing was done from the hip. And that's because of Brian's ability and Brian's planning. Al thought it was one of the great moments in filmdom, and it was.
And then a sort of gun battle ensues, which for me made it be the longest escalator in the history of that sort of device.
He's there!
And part of the fun for me was to be able to edit it in a way that the audience doesn't really think that it's taking a long time for him to ride down this escalator, but rather they're so involved in the action that the way that Brian has staged these pieces that you don't think about that.
It goes 1, 2, 3. It goes Joe, Richie, Frank.
You got it.
He's here!
We don't want the audience thinking about the physical nature of how short or how long the stairs were, but in fact, as an editor, you do, and you try to make sure that that doesn't become an issue for the audience.
What I try to show is the kind of the succession here. I've seen this myself. Sometimes the older knock-around guys, especially if they've done substantial time, when they come out, newer cadres have risen in their wake, so to speak. There's a certain resentment on the part of the old-timer for the young buck coming up. Carlito has an inherent distaste or dislike for Benny Blanco, but of course, as pointed out by the club owner, Benny Blanco is just a younger version of Brigante. That's all he really is. And then, of course, this guy circles around and then treacherously whacks him out.
Hey, remember me? Benny Blanco from the Bronx?
I didn't anticipate writing any sequels to the sequel. He was finito, okay? The publisher, I remember, said, no, he is not dead. He could be revived with some radical surgery and we could write a third episode. But as far as I'm concerned, that's the end of Brigante.
Shh, Johnny's talk, Charlie. We're gonna get you to a hospital.
The story really only worked if he died. And we used to joke about how we were gonna do the reshoot after the first test screening when, you know, where Carlito miraculously lives, where he pulls back his shirt to reveal a bulletproof vest. In fact, while we were shooting the scene where he dies, Brian said, should we do the bulletproof vest shot now or later?
The idea of starting the movie in black and white with a gunshot and then bringing them back to the exact same scene in the end in color was something that I figured out while I was laying out the movie. And I thought it would be an incredible trick to bring somebody, it's almost like a deja vu experience where you bring them right back to a place they've been before, they've seen before. It looks different, but there's something strangely familiar about it, which is sort of a great literary tradition.
One common misperception that people have about the word romantic is that it ends with two people walking away on a beach together.
Charlie, don't leave me, Charlie.
The whole idea of something being truly romantic is that it's about loss. And that's what so many of Brian's movies are about. Really, all of them, if you think about it. Loss of innocence, loss of true love, loss of life. Truly romantic is to find that which is just absolutely ideal for you, that which seemed unattainable in life, and then to find out that it is. I remember in Carlito's death scene, Brian brought in some big speakers and blasted some very moving stuff. I think it was just for the first couple takes to sort of get them into the mood, and then he cut it off for the stuff he was really going to use. The moment the score goes in is incredibly exhilarating.
Patrick Doyle did a fantastic job because we had to come up with the right kind of sorrowful orchestral kind of score. We talked about Mahler a lot. And I tend to drive my composers pretty hard now in terms of the kind of scores I want. I'm very familiar with the whole process now. I'm not interested in a cut and paste score where they just sort of follow whatever temp track you put in. The really great composers never even listen to temp scores. And Patrick and I were very successful with this particular score.
I was surprised by some of the negative reviews we got on Carlito.
A few weeks before it came out, Brian said, listen, don't get your hopes up too high, because I'll tell you how it's going to break. he said, here's what the media wave will say. Al sucks because he just won the Oscars, so it's time for him to be down. You suck because you just did Jurassic Park. He said, Sean is brilliant because he hasn't worked for a couple of years, and it's time for Sean to be brilliant. And me, the pretty good, but because they kicked the shit out of me on Bonfire of the Vanities and Raising Kane, but they still don't want to fully embrace me, so I'll sort of get away with it. And he was right, sort of right down the line. Those were how the reviews broke.
Some of these same reviewers have now, you know, retracted their reviews, certainly in terms of how they discuss Carlito.
In retrospect, it's the one people always comment about to me. I mean, people really love the movie. Now,
Carlito's Way is one of the best films I have ever been involved in. For me, it's a perfect movie. It's perfectly cast. The music is perfect. The visual aspect is just wonderful, okay? And I'm very proud of the movie.
Okay, let's rehearse again, please, with playback.
I'm basically counterculture. I've always been counterculture since I started in the 60s. I've always followed what I thought was right, no matter what was considered politically correct. I'm the one that has to sit in the end and look at my movies and either be satisfied with them or dissatisfied with them. And when I was looking at, Carlito's Way, I just got a new computer and it has a DVD player on it. And I said, well, what's this? Let's look at this DVD. And I started to look at the beginning and I said, this is really good. It's great when you get so far away from the movies, you look at them like you're just watching, you know, a great old movie. And you go, wow. Who did this? This is good. The best part is basically writing the script or storyboarding the sequences, trying to figure out how to shoot everything, going to the locations. When it's all in your head and you see all the images being assembled in a way that they have infinite possibilities. The making of the movie is, you know, something Truffaut, I think, said, you know, you have to, you know, you're basically trying to get just 50% of what you have in your mind, and then you'll be happy. It's basically, you're settling. Sometimes you're surprised, and it's better than what you imagine. But it's, again, it's a great struggle between the realities of the filmmaking process trying to keep this vision in your head and getting it on film. And it's either works or it doesn't work. And the movies basically have to stand up for themselves. I mean, anybody who's watching them in 10 or 20 years is basically the key. And I think this DVD revival is what it's all about. You revive some movies, like you keep publishing some books, you know, and 10 or 20 years away, you look at them like you look at any movie that you like or either dislike. You watch it for a while and get bored with it and turn it off, or you just can't stop watching it.